That movie, there is a movie. How many of you saw the movie? I Can Only Imagine. I want our young people to see that movie because it's a powerful movie. It's based on a true story, and how the young man who wrote that song out of a life of great struggle and great challenge. And he ended up writing that song. I thought it's a kind of an incredible song. I think it's the most popular Christian song ever, other than Amazing Grace. I mean, modern day songs, and it solely captured my imagination the first time I heard it. So I think it beautifully describes, you know, what's in your heart, which is almost impossible to express, how you long one day to see the Lord face to face. Matthew chapter 2. I'm not going to be long this morning. I want to pick up the narrative in verse 13. Matthew chapter 2, verse 13. Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, "Arise, take the young child and his mother, and flee to Egypt, and stay there until I bring you word, for Herod shall seek the young child to destroy him." When he arose, he took the young child and his mother by night and departed for Egypt, and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophets, saying, "Out of Egypt I called my son." Then Herod, when he saw that he was deceived by the wise men, was exceedingly angry, and he sent forth and put to death all the male children who were in Bethlehem and in all its districts from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had determined from the wise men. Then was fulfilled that was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet, saying, "A voice was heard in Ramah, lamentations, weeping, and great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, refusing to be comforted, because they were no more. But when Herod was dead, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt, saying, 'Arise and take the young child and his mother and go to the land of Israel, for those who sought the young child's life are dead.' Then he arose, took the young child and his mother, and came into the land of Israel. When he heard that Archelaus was reigning over Judea instead of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there, and being warned by God in a dream, he turned aside into the region of Galilee. He came and dwelt in a city called Nazareth, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophets, 'He shall be called a Nazarene.'" May the Lord rest me to his word and may be sanctifying our hearts. Let's pray, shall we? Father, we're so grateful for another opportunity to be with your people. We thank you, Lord, for the ministry of music of the choir. We thank you, Father, for the gifts of your people toward the furtherance of this ministry. We thank you, Father, for this opportunity now that we have to come together and gather around your word. We pray that you anoint our hearts, our minds, our souls, our spirits, Lord, to hear what you have to say to us, that it will feed our souls. It will encourage our hearts and our minds, Lord, and strengthen our spirits, that we might go on in your name for another day, serving you and representing you. Open the heart of that man, that woman, Borg, who's never come to faith in Christ. And may they believe today, and may they be saved. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I want to talk this morning just briefly from a subject of religious refugees. Religious refugees. If you've been watching news at all, I mean, it has captivated the national news cycle. This whole conversation regarding how we should secure our southern borders. Now, I can say to you, I don't have a clue of what to do. This is far above my pay grade, and that's why we have a democratic process. We elect people that run for office and win office, and we have career people in government, and they study these immigration issues and national security issues, and hopefully they can come up with the best possible answer to solve a dilemma. But right now we have a partial government shutdown. I think it's affecting some 800,000 people. And this whole idea of how to secure our southern borders has certainly become a major political football. Whether we're going to build a wall and not be a wall, we call it the bamboo curtain, the beaded curtain, whatever we call it. But I think that most reasonable people would agree that we do need to have some type of border security post 9/11. That we have to know who's coming into this country, who's here, who's supposed to be here. That's probably something we need to know. And how we get there is something we certainly need to be in prayer about. And we need to be praying and asking the Lord to help our political officials. They need help. They've got to come to some reasonable compromise. No one's going to get everything that they want. But this issue has to be resolved. The government has to be funded. We got to move forward because there are other things that are pressing this nation that needs to have attention. And not just this one issue cannot continue to dominate much of the political cycle. So as a church family and as Christian people, we just need to be praying and ask the Lord to give somebody the influence to be reasonable and to try to bring the sides together to try to come up with the right solution. That's something we as the people of God can do and something that we should be doing. I am not a world traveler. I've only been outside of the United States twice in my life. The one time I was in Canada, which was almost like not being out of the United States, but it's a beautiful country. In the western part of Canada, just absolutely beautiful, breathtaking, as a matter of fact. And some of the nicest people in the world are the Canadians in that part. I was kind of amazed at how nice those people were and how they treated me when I was there. And I was in a place where there were no people of my hue, no brown people. But those people treated me like I was an ambassador from the United States of America, and I was up there almost a week. It was a wonderful stay. But I was glad to get back home, nevertheless. I was in central Mexico, and that was an experience. That was really being outside of the United States. I mean, down in one of the poorest regions of Mexico, where people lived in houses that had paper board for sides, tin roofs, and dirt floors, and they in there 25 and 30 deep. It was poverty on a scale that I never saw before in my life. And I could only think as I was reflecting about it, the people down here, they would give all of their teeth to be able to move in a public housing project in the United States of America. I mean, they would give everything to do it. I mean, the poverty was just kind of unbelievable. And we had down there on a mission trip, and we were giving away old cheap T-shirts. You'd have thought we were giving those people mink stoles. The appreciation and the gratitude they had for the meager little gifts that we gave to them was kind of unbelievable. But it taught me a lesson. It taught me an incredible lesson that this is probably the greatest experiment in the history of human mankind. This nation right here, it taught me a lesson. And when I'm watching these news reports, and don't get me wrong, this is not a political statement, I can understand why people walk from El Salvador, San Salvador, Central, I don't care where they are, to try to get here. I can get it. I really can get it. Because when you can't find decent water to drink, I accidentally took a sip of water. I mean, just quickly before I thought about it, and I was sick for 2 days. And we had taken suitcases full of water because the guy who brought us down has told us, don't drink the water. First thing he told him, y'all system cannot tolerate the water down here. It's not clean like your water and so forth. And so what I'm trying to tell you, I would have walked to get back home. To get back to this land, I would have walked from way down in central Mexico after being down there for over a week. I said, it's time to go home. So I understand it. I really do get it. I get why those people want to come here. I get why they want to risk life and limb just to get here because they still believe there's opportunity here. And so I'm hoping that our young people are paying attention to this because this is a moment in time in the history of this country. It's a moment in time in the history of this country that's going to kind of determine where we move and how we move forward. And dealing with the diverse people groups that are coming into this country it's just a fact of life that we got to deal with, and we got to figure out how to manage it. And we don't see it in West Virginia. We don't see the diversity that exists in other parts of the United States of America. So we don't see it. We seldom hear people not speaking English. Maybe you go to a Mexican restaurant or a Chinese restaurant, but you go into parts of California, you go in parts of Florida, you go in parts of Texas, Arizona, Nevada, you might not hear nobody speak English. And so our nation is changing. The demographics are going to change dramatically just over the next decade. And I think eventually we're going to start even seeing some changes, even in West Virginia, if West Virginia is going to survive. If West Virginia is going to be competitive economically, we got to get somebody in here that's willing to work and work very hard. And our border states have people that's coming in, and they will work, and they will work very hard. And we got a lot of people trying to get down to see Chancellor. The Social Security ought to figure out how now to work. Now, I understand that some people are physically disabled and they shouldn't be working, but we got the highest rate in the country of people who got a disability who get a check for not working. Eventually, it cripples us at a state. We cannot compete with neighboring states. We don't have a workforce to fill the jobs of people that would show up every day that are drug-free and that's going to put in the work. And so these are things that as a nation we got to grapple with and struggle with. And as a church, we have to be enlightened so we can pray intelligently, because we need for somebody in political office to really be trying to fix things. Well, this is timely as we come to the end of the Christmas season, because Jesus was a refugee. Joseph and Mary, they were refugees. They were religious refugees fleeing persecution. I just read it there in your text. When Jesus was born, Herod, who was the king of Judea, who was a despot, who felt threatened by this thought that somebody was born with a pedigree could dislodge him and keep him from willing his authority to his sons. And so he put out a decree that all the children 2 years and under in and around Bethlehem were to be killed. Genocide. Wipe them out. Execute them all. To eliminate any possible threat. And so the text, as we read in your hearing, God appeared to Joseph in a dream, and he said, time for you to pack your belongings, and for you and your wife and the baby, and y'all get yourself over in Egypt. I'm glad Egypt didn't have a wall. I'm glad they had an immigration, that they let them come in. So they come into Egypt as religious refugees. But I'm going to show you how God works. But you know the Christmas story, how the wise men, the delegation that came from the east, and they brought to the baby Jesus, this king, these gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Now that should be an example to us in terms of how we should think about getting someone a Christmas present. Get them something they're going to need, something they can use, and something that really has some utility. Now, Joseph didn't know they were going to have to leave, but Joseph was just a working class individual. He had no great means of money, and he wasn't a native of Bethlehem. His family was from Bethlehem of Judea, but he was from Nazareth of Galilee. And they had made that long trek from the north as a result of the census to come back to the place of their parents' ancestry to pay their taxes. And so he didn't have a whole lot. And so God providentially bought them some provision and bought them gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And these were commodities that had some real value to them. They could be gold, of course, it was the currency that could be liquidated into cash in any country. Frankincense was also and myrrh were also very exotic and expensive herbs that could also be sold as well. And so what the Lord was doing, he had made provision for them when they went into Egypt so that he would have the means to take care of his family while he was in this situation of being in exile, of being a religious refugee. And so God always provides for his people. That's the point. That God always provides. What we have to do is exercise wisdom to make sure that we don't squander away our provision. That we don't squander away our provision. We live in the day and age that if we got checking accounts, as long as we got checks, we should keep writing. That's not the way it works, right? That's not the way it works, right? The check is the symbolic of I should have money to support this check. And so gone are the days of saving anything, of saving for a rainy day, putting something aside, of trying to be thrift, trying to be enterprising. And so now we find ourselves now living from paycheck to paycheck, always just trying to get by, because we live in a culture that it tempts us every single day to live above our means, to live above our means. We're tempted to do that. You know, I went down into the mall. I don't go to the mall much. I remember one of the great philosophers says that he loved to go to the marketplace. He loved to go to the marketplace to see all the things that he can do without. I choose not to go to the marketplace because I see things that I could do without, convince myself that I need them, and I might buy them when I can't afford them. So I just try to stay out of the marketplace. I bet you I ain't been in the mall 10 times in the last 10 years. I don't go. But I have a family, a whole family for the people. Oh, they gonna patronize that mall. I mean, they ought to buy stock in it. I don't sell the mall that's going out of business just with my family. I can't get it. Let me tell you, I went to the mall and I was surprised. I was utterly surprised. It wasn't hardly nobody in there. And that was the week before Christmas. I could not believe it. It was all type of stuff in there, all types of nice stuff, but wasn't hardly nobody in the mall. And I said, where is everybody? So now I understand why the towns on the mall is in financial trouble. Because someone told me the other day, it was down a couple days after Christmas, I'm surprised how light the crowd was in the mall. And so maybe people are getting some sense to realize we can't empty that mall. They bring trucks in there every day to fill it up. No matter how much we spend, there's always going to be replenished. Joseph and Mary, they understood this idea that they were in a difficult situation, they were in a hard press, and they had to manage well the resources that God had provided for them. The other thing I want to see in this text is that this flight into Egypt really was to fulfill a prophecy. The Old Testament prophet Hosea, in Hosea chapter 11, a little obscure prophecy, talked about, out of Egypt I've called my servant. And so to fulfill the Old Testament prophecies, God used the hostility against Jesus that Herod had wanting to exterminate this possible threat to his throne. He then takes him into this foreign country. He would then call him out of this foreign country as the prophets had said to fulfill the biblical prophecy. And so God is always at work. God is always leading, he's guiding, he's directing, he's ordering our footsteps if we will have an ear to hear what the Lord has to say. The Bible then says is that after some time had passed, and it was several years actually that it passed, that Herod died, verse 19. But when Herod was dead, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt, saying, arise and take the young child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel, for those who sought the young child's life are dead. Now, before we unpack that, there's one other thing I want to go back and revisit. If you back up a couple of verses, verse 16 actually says, after Herod realized he had been tricked and he was very angry and he ordered the execution of all the children, it says, then was fulfilled what was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet, saying, a voice was heard in Ramah, lamentations, weeping, and great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, refusing to be comforted. That's an interesting text that Matthew introduces. If you go back in the book of Genesis, you might want to write this reference down. In Genesis 35, verses 16 through 20, in Genesis 35, 16 through 20, it's the first time there is a reference in the Bible to Bethlehem. And the reference to Bethlehem is that Rachel, the wife of Jacob, the wife that he loved, Rachel gives birth to her firstborn son, Benjamin. And she calls him Benoni, the son of my sorrow. And they were very close to Bethlehem, and that's the first time that Bethlehem is mentioned in the scripture. Her husband, Jacob, then changes his name to Benjamin, which means the son of my right hand. So what became, in Rachel's mind, the son of great sorrow, Jacob says, no, this is going to be the son of my right hand. Rachel was very complicated pregnancy. She dies in childbirth. And so, and being sick and the pain of childbirth, she thinks it's a time of great sorrow. Jacob changes his name to son of my right hand, and at the inn and near Bethlehem. Now, the key spiritual insight there is that Jesus will be both referred to as one who was acquainted with sorrow and grief, Isaiah 53, verse 5. He was bruised for, he talks about him, the iniquities of our iniquities being upon him, but by his stripes we were healed, and he was associated with grief and with sorrow. But after his death, burial, and resurrection, he would also be elevated to sit at God's right hand. And so God can turn a situation around, a situation that appears to be a time of great sorrow and of great pain, of great grief and great heaviness. God can use that same event to catapult us to a totally different place. As he does Bethlehem, the place of sorrow for Rachel, it becomes the city of bread, and it becomes the place that the bread of life is born, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who was born in Bethlehem of Judea. The text goes on to say that a voice was heard in Ramah. Now, this is interesting. It is interesting because during the Babylonian captivity, when Jerusalem fell, when Nebuchadnezzar came in, if you read that account very, very closely, you'll find that they took some of the captive Jewish men, they took them to Ramah. And Ramah was in the land of Benjamin. And so it was as if the prophet was saying that Rachel is weeping over these sons that have been led into captivity. And this was during the Babylonian captivity. So the prophet Jeremiah basically said that had two focuses. One was the sons being led into captivity, the sons of Benjamin being led back in this area. The other being the fact there will come a time when there would be the sons of Israel would be murdered at the hands of Herod. And so these sorrowful situations, very painful situations, come on the heels of the birth of Christ, on the heels of this great celebration. The angels are proclaiming great tidings of great joy. And that's the way life is. And that's why we got to walk very carefully. We walk by faith and not by sight. We recognize that we can be high today, celebrating some great joy, some great victorious situation, and less than 24 hours can be like someone has taken a pen and stuck it into our balloon and just burst it. We can be totally deflated. That's the way life is. But the constant is whether we high on the mountaintop of ecstasy or we low in the valley of grief and bereavement, the constant is God has promised to never leave us nor forsake us. So God is going to be with us no matter what the situation or the circumstance is, and we draw our strength, we draw our courage, we draw our resolve to fight on and to march on because God has promised to never leave us nor forsake us. And so we see this right here in this story. And we've witnessed it as we've heard testimonies this morning, as families have celebrated the Christmas season, the holiday season, and now their some have been plummeted into grief and sorrow and great heaviness. That's just the way it is in life. And that's just the story of way the ebb and flow of life is. There's sorrow, there's pain, but there's also great joy. But through the whole process, God has promised to never leave us nor forsake us. One more point before we take our seat. Verse 17, then was fulfilled what was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet, saying, a voice was heard in Ramah, lamentations, weeping in great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, refusing to be comforted because they were no more. You know, I've been reading some of these stories, and you know what's true or what's exaggerated, but that in some of these Central American countries that the violence is so bad, where they're trying to recruit these young boys into these drug cartels and force them into these gangs. That these mothers basically are trying to find somebody going this way or coming this way. And they said, will you take my son? Will you take my children? That's how desperate these people are, that their children would have a future, a chance at life. The people here, they are critical, and I understand that because it's easy for us to criticize from the comfort and the convenience of our family room, watching on television. It's a lot different if we were in the crucible of the pressure of seeing kids being gunned down in the streets, kids being pulled into gangs, young girls being driven into human trafficking. If we was living under those type of situations, circumstances, there might be a desperation that we might have to try to get our children out of that environment, to try to get them to another place. All y'all listen to me. There was a time in the southern states in this country that mothers were doing everything they could to get their sons, get them out of the south, put them on the first train going north somewhere, some rally, someone who had gotten out of the south because of the time when men were being lynched every day in the south. And so this is the pain that people are living with, the burden that people are living with. And so we know that this is a complicated situation. We know we have to secure our borders. We know we cannot have open borders and let people come here unchecked. We understand that. But at the same time, we must recognize there are desperate people all over the world. And they look at this place still as the promised land. And the teachable moment that we have is to sit our children down and get them to pay attention to this, to realize this must be a special place. If people would risk life and limb to get here, there's something they've heard about this place that make it special and unique. And maybe you need to see that there are special and unique things about this place to where every child, think about it. We are a unique experiment. We're a unique experiment in West Virginia. As backwards as we're supposed to be, as bad off as we're supposed to be, 49 for 50 and almost just about everything. Don't you know when they founded the state of West Virginia, they wrote in the Constitution that West Virginia had to provide free education for everybody? And as poor as those hillbillies were, they recognized the power of education. And don't you know that as poor as West Virginia is, as backwards as West Virginia is, as uneducated and as uncouth as West Virginia is, don't you know that we're among the 15 top states in the United States of America on what we spend on public education? Don't you know they passed a lawsuit that went past several years ago? Judge Rett just died last year, one of the most important circuit judges in the history of the state of West Virginia. When Rett was a judge, a case came through, I think it was down in Lincoln County, one of them poor counties somewhere. And the case came before Judge Rett, and Judge Rett ruled, I don't care where a child is in the state of West Virginia, they'll be guaranteed a free and effective education. Don't you know that? Don't you know that even these poor counties, as poor as they might be, with very poor property tax base, that the state of West Virginia has to subsidize those counties so they have money, so they can have schools and teachers? This is in West Virginia. In the state of West Virginia, with all of our problems, the schools are still open every day. Buses are still running. Free lunches are still being served. Don't you know that in Kanawha County, Warner County, everybody get to eat free when you go to school at least twice, breakfast and lunch, and it don't cost you a penny? And some of the kids, they pack them bags to take home over the weekend. We got to see the opportunity. And we got to seize the opportunity, and we got to lay hold to the opportunity, and that's who God can bless. God can bless folk who are trying and putting forth their best effort. And that's why you young people, you got to go to school every day. You got to listen. You got to pay attention. You got to respect the principal, respect the teachers, and try to learn everything you can to get as much as you can, because that's your ticket for a future. Your ticket for the future is to be able to be a lifelong learner, to be able to reinvent yourself, to make yourself marketable and profitable to the economy, to be able to start your own business, to be able to make your own money. This is where we're headed as a country. And so the writer says, Rachel was weeping over her children, and Rachel representing the the mother of Israel, weeping over the condition of her children. Y'all know where I'm going with this, don't you? There's a time now that we need to be weeping over our children. We need to be weeping over their lack of interest in spiritual things. We need to be weeping over the lack of motivation and determination and resolve and commitment to do what's right, no matter what the odds are that against them. We need to be weeping over the fact that very often they're quick to find an excuse and to sit down and to quit and not try and not put forth the effort. You know what one of my prayers is? Might sound strange. My prayers is maybe some of these people that come here illegal, God will bring some people here to love the Lord. We need some evangelists. We need some preachers. We need some people to love God, going to serve God, and going to preach this gospel and spread the gospel. We need some men that's going to raise up the children the right way and stay with their wives, their family, and just hang in there to try to make it work the best they can and be the best provider they can possibly be. We need a change in this country. We need a turn. We need a spiritual turn in this country to turn things around. And so Rachel was weeping over her children. The spiritual mother was weeping over her children because she understood, so goes the children, so goes the land. So goes the nation of children, so goes the nation. And the hallmark of this great republic is there have been young people that had vision and that had courage, willing to die at disproportionate numbers in every war that we have fought. Have led every great movement. It's been young people say, we can have a better country. We can have a better nation. And we want to have a better nation in a better country. And somebody got to be willing to sacrifice so that we can have a better nation in a better country. It's just like the old Chinese proverb, somebody plants the tree, somebody else enjoys the shade. We don't all get to enjoy the benefit of our labor. We don't all get to enjoy the benefit of our labor. Sometime the benefit will be there will be something there for someone else to benefit. And our reward will be when we get to the other side and God says to us, well done, you good and faithful servant. You did something. Now let me show you the impact. Let me show you the legacy that your life had. I was reading an article in the paper the other day as I get ready to take my seat. That in our state right now, we have one of the highest rates in the United States of America of grandparents raising their grandchildren. My little town, Mount Hope, West Virginia, it has one of the highest in the state. You know what I can say? Thank God for grandparents. Thank God for grandparents. Because we're at a point right now where grandparents got to stand in the gap. Kids act like they ain't got no sense. Somebody got to have some kind of sense. Because those children belong to the grandparents. They wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the grandparents. And I tip my hat to the grandparents who are trying to do the best they can to give their children a chance of a life. And I tip my hat to the churches like the Grace Bible Church and other churches who recognize that the children, they are our most precious and valuable resource. And we got to invest in them and try to win them to a vision of moral excellence, spiritual excellence, physical actions, intellectual actions. We got to convince them that you are different if you know Jesus Christ. You have all that you need to be a model citizen, a top citizen with God in your life and with people that care about you. And hold your head up high and commit yourself to being the best person you can possibly be. Rachel wept for her children. But God had a ram in the bush, and he was going to be the Savior, Jesus of Nazareth. And he had a mother and he had a father, and they took him to a little obscured village, Nazareth of Galilee. Verse 23 says, and he came and dwelt in a city called Nazareth, that there might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophets. He should be called a Nazarene. As I shared with you last week, it don't matter where you came from. What matters is where you are now and where you choose you want to go. What matters is where you are now and where you choose that you want to go. I think one of the most encouraging things the Lord put in the Bible is the fact that Jesus was born in humble circumstances. His family had to flee to protect his life. Comes back to Israel, and then he goes, and he's in this little village that everybody despised, that everybody hated. They rejected. They thought that they were spiritually inferior because of the influences of the Samaritans and the nations that had conquered the northern part. They thought that they didn't have the right pedigree to do anything significant, anything of any real importance. And so they looked down upon them. And God placed his Savior to be raised in this little obscure place everybody else looked down upon. And this little obscure place would produce the Savior of the world. And it would take away the sting and the stain and the disgrace of the name of the place. Well, I say to you this day, is you know, we never know what God has put us here to do. We never know. Some of us come from very humble backgrounds, very humble upbringing, very, very, very dysfunctional situations. I was with a friend of mine yesterday, the day before yesterday, we were talking about just how dysfunctional lives are, people's lives are. But I said, you know, even in this dysfunction, God is still God. God is still God. And God can still do great things, marvelous things. As we come to the end of this year, 2018, and we stand on the threshold of 2019, I hope that we will just renew ourselves to believing that God can still do great things. And he can take a little humble band of disciples, and he can use them to turn some children around and turn some parents around and turn some fathers around and maybe turn a part of a community around so the seeds of spiritual revival can be sown. Amen? I just want to see some people get saved. I just want to see some people get saved and living for the Lord, to give God a chance to show the difference that he can make. We didn't try out everything else. I tell people all the time, this didn't work, that didn't work, this didn't work. Maybe give the Lord a try. Give the Lord a try. See what he might be to do. Amen? Let's bow for prayer, shall we? Father, we're so grateful as we wrap up this holiday season, the first advent of our Savior. And we see how our Lord himself was born into a house.